It's definitely a momentum thing and a habitual thing. I'm big into like, you have these things that you're grounded in or something you want to do, and over time, exactly what you said, now it's not, it's just like second nature, or it just is what it is. Hey buddy, we're live after almost a week of trying to figure it out.
It's not even trying to figure it out, dude. It's just been finding the time.
No, that's what I meant. Finding the time
and trying to figure it out.
No, I actually meant finding the time. Finding the time where we have an abundance of time.
Okay. Also, really quickly, I do want a sip of your drink. He offered it to me before, and I wasn't really feeling it because it's got regular milk in it. Does it?
Yeah,
I'm not.
I figured you weren't a regular milk guy.
Oh, double straw? Wow.
That's how they do it here in Poland, I guess.
Yo, that's wild. Nice, huh? Yeah, that's
good. Iced no latte, if anyone was wondering.
That's really good, dude. It tastes like a straight up absolute granule of sugar, like a giant granule of sugar. But coffee guy, you're not a coffee. You are a coffee guy?
I am
not?
A coffee guy, but like not straight up coffee, not European style. Just take a shot of coffee.
So you're the more like... Frappuccino guy?
No, not a frap guy. Just a simple like iced vanilla latte or like simple.
You posted a video of you drinking a shot of espresso, and it was pretty hard to watch. Is that how it felt?
It was hard to watch. Yeah, that is how it felt. It was rough. It was my first time. I like it. I realized you can't just like sip it. You got to just go. I had a couple shots after that.
Wow.
Of coffee.
Italians are absolutely fucking cringing right now.
Yeah, they cringed on my post too.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, it's not a shot of espresso. You don't just take it down like a shot.
That was the joke.
You got to milk it. It's like having good whiskey or good tequila.
That's what they said. That no, they're like, oh, as Americans call it, a shot of coffee. Yeah. Anyways.
How are you doing?
Good. We're here at the World Championships.
We are. We're here at World Championships. Let's set the scene a little bit. We're here in Katowice, Poland. Sunny day today. I know. I'm a little bummed we're not outside because, quite honestly, this is the most pale I've ever been in end of August, and it's absolutely destroying my soul.
He's been stressing about it.
I've been stressing about it. I'd like to know from you, where do you fall on that? Like, how much do you care about your bronze levels? Also, really quick, you're Italian?
I am Italian.
Yeah, that's why you got sweet hair. And ooh, that's why it looks like you maintain a good bronze.
Yeah, I would say, to answer the question, I don't worry about it. It just is. There was one time, though, I realized my freshman year that I was, like, really white. I took a picture, and I realized, like, months later, I think it was February or January of my freshman year in college. And, you know, you go the whole fall and, like, into that winter of not being outside, you're in the gym all day, and I was like, oh my goodness, I need to get some sun. Like, this is a problem. But other than that one time, at least that was the only time I noticed. So,
which basically means you've maintained a consistent bronze throughout probably your entire life, because you grew up in California.
Yeah, Santa Clarita, sunny Santa Clarita.
Santa Clarita. And Santa Clarita is like not LA, but somewhere around there.
Yeah, like north of LA, inland a little bit, maybe 40 minutes. You never know with traffic. Could be like 2 hours.
Yeah, we talked a little bit about it earlier when we were laying in bed one time. Also, we're roommates. This is actually a coincidence.
Yeah, this wasn't planned. Like, I was not hired to be here.
No, you weren't hired to be here. Quite frankly, I've never hired anyone to be here. And you're not the first. We happen to be roommates. And
it's an amazing time. But the story of how we became roommates is actually a good one. But... speaking of bronze, I got 2 bronze medals this summer, if that's what you were talking about.
Very sick. Not what I was talking about.
I did maintain my bronze this summer. But we're going for gold.
We're
going for gold here at World
Champs. That just pops me into one of the thoughts I had. And one of those was, the other day you said mother trucker. I just want to know what that's about. Yeah, I heard it, dude.
Wait, where? In practice?
No, you said it. I don't know what you were doing.
Oh, I got hurt, huh?
You maybe stubbed your toe or something?
Yeah, what was it? Mother trucker.
Mother trucker, dude. I want to talk about it because from what I've learned about you, you don't swear. You don't really drink. You're like fully sober.
What do you do?
No, dude, it's not that. Here's what I'll tell you, dude, is I'm not that way at all. I swear, I'm just myself. You know, I don't think about it. And what I actually love about getting to know you is you're a religious man. You are sober. You don't swear. And you're just so authentically yourself. And I think that's got to, I can imagine that's tough when most of the kids that are around like a college environment do swear. They do party in ways where there's drinking and drugs. And like what's that like for you?
It's a really good question. Broad question, open question. What's that like for you? You know? Well, I guess I'd just start off by saying like all those things. Yeah, that's
let's
true.
Let's start by figuring out what's going on with Mother Trucker, dude, and what else you got in the bag.
What else do I? Wait. Let me quickly answer this. I'll just say, in simple terms, it's me, and like it always has been me. So in terms of myself and like how I go about it and deal with it, or just like it's just me, you know. Like you said, that's my authentic self. I don't have a problem with it. I don't have a problem with what other people do, but that's just. This is how I roll. No, you know?
Totally. And I love that. And I really actually respect that about you. And that's why I'm so curious, like as someone who's not that way, but it sounds like, you know, you grew up in a pretty religious home. And yes. So did I, you know, and we turned out.
I just thought of one of my words. That's why.
What is the word?
Keep going. No, we'll save it.
No, what's the word?
Okay. So I used to say it a lot. I got to bring it back. Frickin' chicken.
Frickin' chicken.
Yeah. I love it.
Wow. Wow, dude. I mean, I can't wait to see how many more phrases come out throughout this podcast. Just for me, anytime you, no matter what's happening, anytime you think of one,
I'm going to blurt it out.
Yeah, just blurt it out. Completely interrupt me. But no, I'm genuinely curious, like, what's it like being a, well, we can break it into little parts.
Yep.
First, I want to know just what's it like being in a college environment surrounded by, I'm assuming you're in the minority.
Yes.
What's that like?
That's a good way to put it. I'm in the minority. Minority.
You're in the minority.
Well, again, it's like cool. Like I'm cool with it. I'm fine being around like things, certain people. It's whatever. Again, it's just like not my way of doing things. Not my lifestyle. But I'll never like put it on someone else. But in terms of being in the minority, I'd say it's, not tough, but you know, you're not in the main group. You're not in what's happening, what's going on. But I really like to stress the fact of like having, I always say like genuine fun, you know, playing games, hanging out with people, having conversations, stuff like this, like to me, real, genuine activities.
And like, did you, assuming you were the same way obviously in high school, like did you ever get made fun of for
saying
shit like friggin' chicken?
No, I feel like it's been maybe early on, but as far as I remember, like it's just been kind of part of my identity, something people learn about me, and just like is what it is. And I guess maybe if people do, I block it out. I don't really like notice stuff like that. But when you asked that, it kind of made me think like in high school, I realized I didn't get invited to like things or like functions or whatever you call them, parties, because people thought that I wouldn't want to go or wouldn't want to hang out or wouldn't want to do whatever they were doing, which is true in some sense that like I don't want to drink or whatever, but I can still hang out, have a good time,
dude.
Be with people. You know what I'm saying?
I gotta know. Like, walk me through what that looks like. You know, you go to like, do you guys do frats and shit over there? Frat house?
Not huge in Long Beach.
Okay, let's just say like a house
sports,
party,
like athlete parties.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, yeah. A house party. You go to a house party. You show up at like 11. Everyone's fucking drunk and like doing whatever. Like, what do you do?
I usually walk in and like yell or just like get super hyped. Either that or I walk in super chill. It depends on my plan. Sometimes I'll like go out which I don't go off. I go like maybe half and half. You know, I don't go to like every party or everything. Depends. Yeah. Like if volleyball is like having something going on, then like I'll go and hang out. But sometimes my plan is just like be chill and like maybe that's the vibe. Sometimes I'm hyped, you know, maybe we just want a game or something and it's like free weekend. Let's go. You know, people will vibe with me. Mason. I don't like, there's this, ooh, shout out to my best friend's girlfriend and her friend. I walk into parties and they'll like start chanting my name and I hate it.
Best friend's girlfriend. Okay.
Yeah, it's awful. But anyways, yeah, sometimes I bring some energy.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. You definitely bring the ruckus, boy. There's no doubt.
Like you know, I have the energy. People know I have the energy, which is kind of one of the reasons like I don't need to or want to drink, I guess.
Yeah.
I just don't feel the need to like. I'm fine socially. I'm fine in terms of energy.
Yeah.
I'm just like with myself. Not saying that other people aren't if they are doing those things, but you know what I mean.
Mason's a humble guy. They're not, dude. Let's be honest. Most of them, you know, they're just looking for validation and just trying to have a good time. And I think the reason I'm actually so curious is because I was not that way. Mm-hmm. You know, like we've had this conversation for sure. And like, it's so interesting because now like I'll still, you know, have a good time. Like I don't have the same feelings towards those things and that's fine. But I think more about like, it's been a new thing for me to like even embrace the concept of going to, I mean, dude, I'm 30. I'm not going to parties really, you know, 29. But like to go, no, I'm 30.
There you go. Dang. I guess we should have started there.
I mean, just you didn't need to interrupt me like that.
Yeah.
It's fine.
Not okay.
It's fine, dude. We're still learning about each other and how we work. But I was just thinking like, dude, it's been a new challenge for me to learn. Can I go to a bar after a game with a bunch of teammates when I'm playing overseas and not have a drink? And for a long time, it's like, I mean, look, drinking personally for me is like, it's never, I don't also feel the need. And as I've gotten older, it's like, dude, I have two beers and I'm like fucking hungover and like swollen. Like it's, I don't have the desire at all, but saying no is like my new challenge. Like, can I just go to a bar?
Yeah.
Or can I go to, I don't know, let's say afterwards they go to like some teammate's house and they're all drinking and stuff. Yep. Like, can I go in that environment and just say no and have a good time? And I'll be completely honest with you. It's hard for me. And so that's why I'm asking from you, like, what are your tips, you know?
Yeah. Well, a couple things. I think first, it's pretty cool because a similar thing I feel like has happened with a couple of my friends or even teammates now or in the past where it's been like a similar, not such an open conversation, but they know that I don't drink and that I don't at all. I think that's one of the biggest things too. To me, it's just always no. So I never really have to make that decision or, you know, differentiate between, okay, I want to drink this time or I want to drink here. To me, it's just like, I don't drink, which is part of the reason in general. You know, it makes things easy. People always ask like, oh, are you going to drink here? Are you going to drink here? If we win, will you drink? It's like, no. That way I don't have to even deal or think about that at all. Because it genuinely is no. Like, I don't want to. I have no interest in. But I have had like a couple instances with like teammates or friends and they've had a similar thing. And I think seeing me and seeing how I go about it and just that's, you kind of make it like part of your identity in a way. And therefore, one, people don't pressure you. And two, they just accept it. It's, you're not like the stereotypical, oh, come on, drink, let's go, like, take a shot, whatever. It's just like, no, like, they know that you don't drink. Or they like, I think if I had to answer in like a one night, like a one-off situation, you just like establish it from the start. It's like, no, I'm not drinking tonight. And then you just like tell yourself that and you tell your people or your friends that and you try and just go about it that way. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I mean, for sure. I think making like really embodying whatever decision you make.
Yeah.
You have to make that decision beforehand, I think.
Exactly.
And luckily for you, it's just never even been like, you don't have the temptation in any way.
Yeah.
which is
yeah,
nice.
It's a different aspect, yeah. You know, when there's the temptation.
All right, so that's what I do want to know now. What are your temptations, dude? Because look, maybe a part of it is like my own. You know, I think I'm someone who's had a really addictive personality, and I've talked about this on the podcast before, and it doesn't have to mean like I'm addicted to drugs or drinking or partying. It's just like, that's just a part of my personality.
It, yeah. Like volleyball.
Just in general, I like to go 100% in whatever I'm doing.
Yeah.
And so I love that you've established, like, especially at such a young age, like who you are, what you stand for. And like, that's just, and you can still authentically be yourself and not. You can be someone who can show up to a party sober and just be that guy who's sober and just fucking manage it and handle it, whether people think you're a fucking dweeb or whatever. Like, I think that's fucking sick, honestly. Yeah. But yeah, now like I always get this way when I meet someone who I'm like, damn, bro, this guy's like clean cut. He's got beautiful hair, nice leathery Italian skin. You know, like he's sober. He's like good Christian guy. Like, do you have like, you got demons or what?
I don't think so.
No demons.
What would be like?
I don't know. Like,
but I do relate with you on the not addictive personality, but like the going all in aspect. Like volleyball, always been all into that. Obviously, you know, college now. This
well,
is
even
this
dude. Even listening like my, to you talk, like even being sober, it sounds like you're like all in on like this is just who I am.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So like, I'm definitely just an all in type of guy. Same thing, you know, volleyball, life, friends, friendships, relationships, always been all in to like that.
My boy's committed, dude. You're a committed guy.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, dude. I mean,
very committed, very loyal, but like hasn't worked out, but we'll figure it out.
Yeah, but I mean, also that's like a pretty, I feel like that's a tough quality to find in a lot of people, specifically men, maybe.
You know, 100%. I have a lot of girl friends and I even like talk to them about that or tell them. That is like, it's interesting. I don't have a sister, but I have a lot of friends and you kind of put up that like barrier, you know, other guys, you're around other guys and it's like, dude, I don't know. I don't know about this person or I don't know about this group in general. You know, it's an interesting thing.
All right. So I'm curious, like all right, first of all, we're all just gonna have to accept the fact that Mason doesn't have demons. And it's not like I'm trying to force you. I appreciate you saying you don't think you have any. Like that's, I'm not trying to like say
if
that.
If something comes up, I'll tell you. But
or force you. No, but I just mean like, you know, I could imagine like, I don't know, like if you're, oh God, it's the worst example. I don't know, if you're like a virgin girl or something and you're just like, you get the temptation, you know, we're like, you know that you could, or like drinking's a great example where it's like, okay, you don't drink. That's fine. You don't drink, but okay, maybe one time I'll have a shot. Or maybe you think about it sometimes.
Yeah,
or
no,
like,
that's
you know,
the crazy, like, at least in that example, like,
yeah,
I don't ever.
Yeah.
And I think it just also stems from like, I've already in my mind, like made that decision for however many years now. And it just like is what it is.
Yeah. And I think to that, it's like, and this is actually how I felt in, I don't want to call it my sober journey, but like from where I came from, like I'm really proud of the steps I've made and like taken to like get comfortable. Like for me, the hardest part was being comfortable, just being sober and in a drunk environment, let's say, you know, and I'm not always that way, but like really trying to get comfortable being like, what do I actually want right now? What do I really want to do? And just doing that.
Yeah. And I will interrupt and like attest to that similar feeling on the front end of it. I think now it's like, that's who I am. That's what I've done, that's what I have been doing and will do, meaning being sober, being around whatever situation sober. But there was definitely some on the front end, meaning like in high school or as I was getting used to being around people that were drinking or people that were doing whatever or parties. Like there's definitely the same feeling on the front end of it. And now I'm like comfortable with that. I've always been comfortable with myself, but now I guess with just the situation in general. Does that make sense?
No, explain it more to me.
So like someone that has been drinking their entire life or someone that is now maybe trying not to drink or trying to be okay with being sober in a situation or for a night or whatever, that feeling of like having to get comfortable with it, having to get used to it, whether it's getting comfortable with the situation or getting comfortable with yourself or probably both, I've had that feeling like a while ago.
Yeah.
But now it's like a learned thing, or it just is what it is. So now it's like not even a thought.
And
that makes sense now.
100%. And it's what I was going to say earlier. Like, I think it's also a product of momentum. And that leads 100%. Into like so many other things that you want to do or pursue in life, or like the person you want to be. It's like you start to build momentum, and eventually you're like, you've been doing the I don't drink, I don't smoke, I don't swear. Like, that's just not my thing. Yeah. This is who I am for so long that it's like you don't even think about it.
Yeah.
You know, your daddy over here, he's transitioning a little bit, you know, not into all those things, but just with my own struggles, you know, and like, and I think it's just such a great, for me, when you were talking, I was thinking like, oh, it's such a great example of the power of like building some momentum with the person you want to be and the things that you want to accomplish, the things you want to do. It's the same in volleyball, right? Yeah. I can imagine, like, because when did you start playing volleyball? When you were like super kid, super young kid?
Yeah.
When you were a super kid?
I was a super kid.
But super short kid. Did you come from a volleyball family or no?
Yeah.
Mom and dad played?
Yeah. Played, coached. My cousins played at UCLA. Older brothers played. Yeah.
Two older brothers? Three?
Two. It's definitely a momentum thing and a habitual thing. Mm. I'm big into like you have these things that you're grounded in or something you want to do, and over time, exactly what you said, now it's not, it's just like second nature, or it just is what it is. But because of the work I've put in the past, or the intention that I've had towards it, whatever it may be.
I think also, like, I can imagine you were raised in a family where, like, maybe are your brothers similar to you or your parents?
Wait, are my brothers similar to me or my parents?
Do your brothers say mother trucker and friggin' chicken?
They're not as similar to me. Definitely not. Which I think about it a lot. Not a lot, but it's just like interesting. Like, I turned out a certain way. My family definitely had the beliefs, I guess, instilled into us.
Okay.
But obviously every kid comes out differently.
Well, and that's why I ask. Yeah. Like, how are you different than your brothers?
I think the biggest thing between me and my brothers, in like just overall, is like me and my mindset. And I guess that's kind of what we've been talking about. It's like I have that mindset of just like being all in, sticking to this, sticking to that. I'm going to do this and I'm going to say it and it's going to happen, you know? Mm. Whereas I think they're a little bit different.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's enough about them, huh? We're here to talk about daddy. Yeah. You're the daddy.
Granddaddy.
I've been throwing around. You guys, I've been using daddy like way too much. It's just so fun to say. And if anyone can be a daddy. Everyone's daddy.
I walk into the room and I'm like, what's up, daddy?
What's up, daddy? It's just contagious, bro. It's so contagious. It's so fun to say. It feels good to say.
Yeah, you got me.
Dude, I'm super curious, like, right away, like, what's it like being here for you?
That's a good question. Talk a little bit more as I chew this ice.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, like, your young blood energy it's clear, you know? It's clear you bring the ruckus, as we said before, and I think also, like, the first thing I think about is like, what's the difference? And I was going to maybe pitch on this later, but like, what's the difference between the college environment you're used to? And I mean, you did VNL stuff too. And now you're here at World Champs, like the biggest tournament in the world. This is basically like even a bigger deal than the Olympics, people say. That's
a joke. I guess
that's a joke, Mason.
But I guess I'll like start there is with your original question is like genuinely the feeling, and it's like I just got the chills, is just like gratitude and it's getting emotional. Just like everything that is, we go back to like me being all in and like my goals and that whole thing is like this has literally been it. Doesn't mean I'm done, you know, but being here, I always just feel like, and like same feeling with going to VNL. It's like, I made this team. I made this roster. I'm here in this moment. There's just like a crazy overwhelming feeling of gratitude for like everyone that's been a part of my journey and my situation, my coaches, my family, like, you know, even people that maybe didn't turn out to be great in my life, but obviously they still had like an impact of where I am now. And I think that's like the number one thing. That's the number one feeling, which is pretty cool.
Mm. You're excited.
Oh yeah.
It's an exciting time.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. It's cool to talk about it because like I'll text with my parents about it or like, you know, like I post about it, but, and like, that's where I kind of realized like, okay, I'm typing this thing out or like I'm doing a little journaling and I've been trying to like stay up with like my, I don't know if that would be like emotions, but just like my thoughts and my feelings on the whole like situation. Mm. And well, that's where it comes like the most is like when I'm like typing something out, writing something out, or like talking about it. And it's like pretty sick.
I want to know from you, do you remember like a specific feeling your first time? What was your first game in VNL? Because this is the biggest, VNL is the biggest tournament you've ever been in with Team USA.
I didn't play in Brazil.
You didn't play?
So like literally Japan, playing against Japan in Italy.
The friendly game. Yeah. Did you have any, did the emotions feel any different than like you're playing a game against someone at Long Beach State?
I tried to go into it like, you know, the whole mindset thing of like, okay, like you're made for this. You're supposed to be here.
In general, like how did you feel like stepping on and like, all right, Mason, you're going to play right now.
Similar in terms of, I think just because of like, that's where my mind was, but definitely. And I always say this, in terms of like playing for your country and like wearing the USA jersey and like national anthem before is like, that is a different thing. And that will always not mean more, but it's just like everyone says it and everyone says in sports, it's to play for your country is different and something bigger than anything that you'll ever play for back home, you know, unless if your country.
What an honorable answer. Well, here's like, okay, let me set the scene for you. Actually, at Long Beach State, this was like maybe 2016. We were playing a friendly match against Japan, actually, at Long Beach State in the Pyramid.
Oh, okay. USA was.
Yeah. This was my first time like being a part of a team. I was like, oh, I'm working towards travel squad.
And it was against Japan?
And it was against Japan. And nice. I played like the end of like the third set or something, mm-hmm. or maybe the third set. And I will never forget like getting subbed in and feeling like spacey, like just... everything was looser and spacier, and it wasn't like, oh, it's me and I'm, you know, this is my team at Hawaii, you know, the which I'd graduated from and played there. It wasn't like anything else. It was like I'm watching myself in third person, and that's one of the first and only times. I think a couple times getting put in randomly throughout 2016, 2017, because I was never like a clear starter or that guy, and I was also never like a shoe in for traveling either. I just remember getting those few opportunities and like feeling like I blacked out. Like it just felt so strange.
I can relate to. I had that more. We did play China in a friendly match in Brazil. And I had that feeling like way more. And I don't know why. It was like way less of a big deal. Like the matches in Italy were like pretty legit. Mm. You know, like they were promoted. There were people there. We played like a more of a full match or whatever, but the one in against China was that feeling of just like, oh shoot, you like feel a little blacked out or something.
Yeah, I mean,
or like when you just stand up and you're kind of like lightheaded, it was like that.
Yeah, it's like it's like almost like on the bench you had your head like dip straight down. You ever like dip your head straight down and then you get up really fast and you get like, whoa.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like, oh. Yeah.
It's like that for me without, you get kind of like a little body high. I'm gonna be honest with you. I love it. You get like a little, you feel a little fuzzy. It's like without that, but your head is just like a little bit.
It keeps it real.
It does keep it real. I was just curious because that was the experience I had. And even the first, I mean, it's pretty awesome that you get to, as a, like a libero, especially
being the second libero. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's freaking awesome, you know? And for me, it was like, I don't even deserve to be here right now, you know? And so like, I remember having so many like different emotions in that moment, and it doesn't matter, it's over. I just was curious, that's really interesting.
No, I would say it's an interesting thing as an athlete because like I would probably have more of those emotions, but as an athlete and like being here, it's real. So you kind of have to like I started with, like you have to tell yourself like, you're here, do it. Like, this is your chance, this is your moment. Like, ball out type of thing. And you probably block out the real emotions or thoughts that could come in. Does that make sense?
Dude, for sure. In fact, like my role on this team has changed, you know, like, and I remember at one point they brought me along. This was for World Champs actually in 2018. And I was playing the best volleyball I'd ever played and was like actually got a chance to start. It was the first time where I was like starting, you know, and didn't finish the tournament starting. And then the following year, I went in as basically like a serving sub to float serve sometimes.
Your serve is gnarly, right?
We've changed it up. Yeah, the serve is we're cooking, baby. But I was float serve. They were like, we need a good float serve guy. So I was that guy. And I remember like not wanting to come in. Like, for example, Kyle Russell right now is like our basically like first guy off the bench to serve the ball. And I remember.
Not basically.
He is.
That's like Hondo his P. role.
Yeah, absolutely. But I remember like, and John, you know, as a coach is like, he just kind of sometimes he'll sit back there and then randomly he could just go, you in to serve, you know, like no warning. Yep,
he did that to
Kyle. I remember like, dude, if I'm being like totally honest, I remember times where he would start coming back and I would like kind of hide.
Really?
Yeah, dude. Cause I was just like, I don't want to go in there and fucking miss a float serve.
Gotcha. Okay. I was going to say, was it that or like the fact that you didn't have a lot of time? Like it was just like a boom, you're in.
No.
You know?
Dude, 100%. It's just like, I think this thought originally came from something you had said before about this idea of like, you deserve to be here owning your moment. I still get it, dude. Like I still battle with that internal dialogue all the time, especially when you're not the guy. When you go, like for me, when I was at Hawaii, especially my last 2 years, like I didn't have fear of anything because I had proven to myself on the court that I was a fucking baller. And that like I can make as however many mistakes because I wasn't a guy who was making that many mistakes. I was playing really good. That pressure, I think, changes so much, especially on the national team. I even feel the same way when I'm overseas. Very much no fear. You got 8 months to prove yourself, you know. Sometimes here, like your chance is like very slim, you know.
Because that is the reality. As much as you want to tell yourself mentally that it's not, that is the reality when it comes to the national team. Because 100%. You have maybe a week to do something, you know?
For sure. And like the coach's decision to like, a lot of times with John, I'm not exactly sure how he feels, you know. It's like, and there's five middles, let's say, or on this trip four, and everyone's good, everyone can go play and get in. So like you have to have some quality, especially during that tournament. It's not like I've had 8 months with him for him to see like throughout all these statistics, like this is where you're at on average,
the longevity,
like, he knows who I am, you know. It's like a lot of times I come in here and it's like, you get a 2 or 3 week training block. Show us what you can do in that time. You go to play. It's like, maybe they're going to throw you in occasionally. You miss a couple serves now. Maybe they pull back. Like you just
there goes
don't,
the trust.
You don't know, dude. And so I still feel like I'll even in practice sometimes, bro, I'm like, my mentality is a little different and I had to like really learn how to control a lot of that. And to your point, like really remind myself that like, this is my life. Yeah. I'm choosing to be here. Like, let's fucking own the moment, which can be hard to do, dude. I'll even like, we'll be serve and pass or something. And it's like this, I know you're not a server, but let me just tell you.
Oh, I'm a server.
I've actually never seen you serve. I have seen you cut sharp on the outside to four. The 4-4 is nice. You have a good 4-4 wrist down. Yeah, it's nice.
But my line shots, I haven't
really seen it. Oh, you did bounce one ball. I think I saw a clip.
Yeah. Dude, you got to check out you haven't seen my serve?
I got to check out your serve.
It's okay. Special.
That's okay. Okay. Wait. So
add the clip.
I'll go to, or like someone in front of me will serve. They'll miss. The next guy will go. They'll miss. And even if it's like a serve and pass, like this morning we had serve and pass. We played Mexico tonight. Yeah. No. But it's like the third. It's the golden rule is don't miss three in a row as a team. Never miss three in a row. And so it's like that third ball. And a lot of times I'll catch myself being like, nah, I'll let like some guy, I'll be like, yo, just pop a float in. Dude, I catch myself to this day doing that. And it's nice for me because when I do, I always catch myself, you know, where I'm like, fuck, dude, I need to get in the mindset of like, yes, how awesome. Now I have an opportunity to serve the ball with some kind of pressure.
Yeah.
Because in serve and pass, there's no pressure, which is why like how relatable to the game is it? I don't really know. But there's an argument to be made there.
Yep.
But I'm more so like, I catch myself all the time, like being a bitch, dude, like kind of bitching out.
I think it's like just sports in general, like that right there is like the moment, and obviously easier said than done. That's the moment where you should want to like get in and be the one that serves the third ball. because just like you said, you can't really practice that or like simulate that unless if you're in the game.
And I think that's why.
So like getting that rep is huge.
And I think also that's why like being in this environment is so good. I know it's been so good for me personally, because when you've been doing something, at least for me, like playing long enough, and you're playing on teams where you're either the guy, like especially in college, like I'm sure you'll graduate being like the libero, or like for me, I was the fucking middle in the league. And then you go overseas and like you're still like, depending on what kind of team you're on, the guy, like they brought you as a foreigner for a reason. And this is one of the only environments I think that really tests my mental capacity, because it's such a short amount of time. You have such a short amount of time to prove yourself. Like I've earned the trust to be confident in myself, and I'm very confident in myself, but I have these moments of doubt, and I always reflect on them, whether it's after, sometimes I'll catch myself in the moment and having the ability to be like, nah, like to your point, like I need to be like, fucking yes, please miss your serve. I can't wait to be the third guy to put a ball in, you know, because that pressure is also so realistic to a game, and getting good at handling that pressure is so important if you want to have like real success at a high level.
Yep.
And the reality is like, you don't get a lot of it when you're super comfortable. Like you're not getting a lot of it. If you're a college player, a high school player, a club player, and you're like the baller on your team, you're not getting that kind of pressure right now.
Yep. And that's why some people crack. It's just like, can't handle it. But I think the big, okay, my favorite point that you made, I had this, I actually had this conversation with someone like 2 days ago on like the mental side of things, is you saying like, oh, when I'm at Hawaii or like my last 2 years, like I was the guy. So I literally like didn't have that feeling of I couldn't make a mistake or whatever. To me, that like when people ask me like, oh, this about mindset or my mindset on things, I think that's like the biggest thing that you can use to like teach or learn, because you go and you play at Hawaii and you're like stress-free, not carefree, but just like you can play, and that's how you should play. And then you come somewhere else, or you come into a new environment, or you join a new team, and you feel that like sense, you can like literally feel it. It's like a little weight on you, and that you can't fully just free up and play exactly how you were to play volleyball. Even anything from like, oh, I just played on the USA team, I should be able to go back to my college team and ball out. Or I just played at an open gym with college guys, I should be able to go play on my high school team. You know, like I think giving that level up and then going back gives you that perspective, maybe. Maybe that's what it is. That perspective and that like actual mindset. Cause usually like with mindset, you kind of have to trick yourself. But now you've actually felt that, and it's like, okay, I'm fine. Like I can do this.
And dude, I also think that's why, and I'd be curious to know from you what you do to consistently try to get your mind in that headspace. Because I know, like, for example, the kids I work one-on-one with, we talk a lot about intention, you know, and like having intention. For some of them, it's like having a volley intentions journal where they spend a little bit of time before or after a training talking about like, okay, what am I going to focus on today? What is my real goal?
Yeah.
And the example I use all the time is like with serving, right? It's like you serve a ball, but you miss hit it and you get like an ace in the corner. And there's so many coaches who are like, a point's a point. And I just could not disagree anymore. To me, I'm constantly judging myself on what was my intention and how did I follow through on that intention?
Yep.
Like serving's just the best example, because it's one of the few times you're like completely alone, you know? And so it's like, okay, I went back to serve, and it was 24-23. If I miss, we lose. Did I have that moment of, oh shit, if I miss this, we're going to lose? Probably to some degree. And then how did I respond to that? And so a lot of times I'll catch myself being like, yeah, I know what's going on. Like I exist in the same world. Like the reality right now is if I miss, we fucking lose this set. And then the other side of it is like, did I also have a moment where I said, you know what? That is the case, but like, fuck it, dude, I'm fucking going for it. Or like, or was I super tactical? Was I able to be like, okay, go back with the same routine, the same idea of like, be fast, contact high on the ball, be fast, drive the ball to where I want it to go, you know? And so my question for you, I guess, would be, do you have things that you do? Because it's so easy, especially in sports and in life in general, to ride your emotions up and down, do you have any practices that kind of keep you grounded in that sense? Specifically, maybe to volleyball, but maybe also not.
It's been interesting because, like our conversation earlier, I feel like so many things are just habitual now. where it's like, that is me, that is what I do. And I've kind of had to like rework it in a way where it's like, oh, why do I do that? Or what do I do? Like noticing what I do or noticing that that's a thing. It's like, okay, if I, like, I've always kind of visualized and just like, not to like an extent of like how visualization's like a thing now where you have like a visualization coach or you like walk through a routine. But I've just always like, I remember myself in high school in the locker room, like literally going through different shots in my head and like tooling hitters and like stuff like that when I hit the good old days. But realizing those things that I do like visualization, and just like even simple terms, like I'm saying, just like imagine yourself diming three passes. Like I'll try and do something like that before and just like get your head in that positive space.
Before games?
Yeah, before games, before practices.
Every practice. Like is it really consistent or is it something you just kind of do when you feel it's necessary?
That. Something I do when I feel it's necessary. I would say I'm pretty consistent on like having an intention. I think that's, you have to go into like training with some sort of intention, even if it's like the simplest thing or something that might not be directly volleyball related, or maybe your intention is like something better with your mind. I'm going to be positive or bring a lot of energy this practice or this game or whatever it may be. So I think intention is pretty important.
Okay, wait.
Visualization aspect. What?
No, I just wanted to mildly shift for a second because you brought up bringing lots of energy and you brought something up to me. And you were like, dude, I got to talk to Josh about cheers. About like getting...
changed the word.
I know, but that's the word you originally used.
Fair.
Okay, so what are we changing the word to?
Chance.
Okay. Chance. Here's what I think of when you said that. First of all, straight up, cringy. For me, it's cringy.
I know, we had this conversation.
And it's totally fine. And it brought me back, like you saying that brought me back to being in college. And thinking about all the like when guys would come out, like I had my own thing that I would do. We would all do like different handshakes and just like the vibe is so different in like the best way ever. When you're like in college and you're with like all your buddies and you guys are just having the fucking best time and you're winning and you're good. Like it's so fun to have those cheers to like house someone or to bounce a ball and look back and your entire bench has just like lost their mind. Like it's such a cool environment. I want to know from you because it's not that like overseas, at least it's not that. And so I'm curious, like, what's that like for you? Or how do you ever feel like, what's up with all these fucking old guys? Like, why are they, no one's got energy around
here? That is the thought. And I love that you just said that and compared it to like pro or this team. And like, I've said it in my head, just like jokingly a couple times, like really realized like these guys are just like a bunch of robots or like that. Obviously I don't think that directly. And there's been like a cool learning curve to it too, where it's like, obviously there's like a seriousness to it, but I think there are times where it's like, you know, maybe it's just this person's 30th year playing volleyball and like certain things aren't exciting to them. You know, I think there's that aspect too. But to me, just overall in general, like energy and like having fun is like are the number one things. And that's why I always bring so much energy and just like have fun. And especially when I'm on the court, you know, like go along with the monster block cheers or chants. What do we say? Chants.
Baby, go with your heart. That's what you do. Go with your heart.
Or like the ace. I don't know. Those type of things. Just like making it fun. Big energy guy.
I think
big team dynamic guy. I think that's something I've noticed too. Like the team strays a little. I think we could get better there.
Before we completely change subjects, I think it's an interesting subject worth breaking down.
Okay.
And here's what I think about. When you're younger, especially, dude, you see this especially at like the club level. Guys get like some crate, like bounce a ball or something, and like everyone goes fucking nuts because it's sick.
Yeah.
You know, and like when you're a kid, that's what you want to do. You want to bounce balls, you want to block balls straight down, you want to lip guys on like a no one up pipe situation. Like those are what you dream for. And I think to your point, it's like, yeah, once you've seen it enough. And that's not even I don't even think it's a question of like once you've seen enough, because guys will do sick plays and I'll be like, oh, fuck, like that is nasty. And I'll react naturally to it. I just think there's this level of, I don't know if you, maybe level of confidence. I don't know if that's the best way to put it, But I think as you get older, to me, it's like, I just bounce that ball, but I better fucking bounce it 9 out of 10 times. Like, that's just what I do. And you know, and that's how I feel a lot of times. Like for me, I've watched how I've developed. Like I used to be like, I had phases of like kind of being the like chirpy guy. I had phases of kind of being the like super stoked guy. And then I played, I remember seeing Max Holt specifically when I was probably 3 or 4 years ago and watching how like, he's just mellow. He just, that was your hip?
Knee.
Oof. He's just like a mellow dude, you know, like super mellow and just like does his thing, does his job, very professional, let's say in that way. And I just like, I guess out loud brainstorming, why is that? Because you're totally right. Like there's some guys are that way, but I think most guys have this kind of attitude of like, yeah, that sick play I just did, that if you're like 16, you're like freaking out. It's like, that's just what I do. So yeah, it doesn't feel genuine to react like the world is ending. I'm so stoked, you know?
Yeah, I get that too. And like, so many thoughts going through my mind, but I guess first one is like, I like celebrating other people. Like, when other people get a point, or like, I think that's huge too. Other people do something sick. Other people, even just the simplest thing, like a nice set, or like they fooled all the blockers. Like, I think that's sick. Doesn't mean you have to go crazy. Doesn't mean you have to like, you know, throw your arms in the air every single time, but at least just like some fire, some intensity. Cause to me, that's like locked in as well. But another thought, you said exactly what someone on my team at Long Beach said is like, that's what I'm supposed to do. Like, why should I cheer? Like, why should I be happy? That's what I'm supposed to do every time. But like, one, you might not do it every time. So like when you do, let's just say it being like, get a kill. When you do, like you can still celebrate it. You can still celebrate the good. Again, it doesn't have to be the biggest thing in the world, or like you just won the championship. Cause we all know that thing. It's like, oh, that team just won. Like that was their championship. You know, that kind of like thing. Of yes, there's a standard that's higher, but I think you can still celebrate or at least have fun with what's going on right now.
I mean, dude, I completely agree.
And you don't have to. And if it really isn't natural, then like, so be it. You can't force it.
I got to focus on my strategic warm-up to get my head in the right place for when I do go on the court, and also my body in the right place for when I do go on the court. And that's what I've, as a bench player now, because, you know, for a while it was like, it hasn't, especially when I'm overseas, I'm not on the bench. So playing a bench role or having to be ready at all times to come off the bench and help someone out or help the team out is like a different role for me.
Same.
And so I think it requires something completely different. Like, okay, honestly, if I was guy, I think, and this is where it's like so nice to have a team where everyone has a different role. If I was guy who just like, yo, you're not going in, I would be king of the let's have a fucking good time, because the team does need it. Having, and I said this from when you first walked in, like having your young energy is so great. It's refreshing for me. I'll tell you, as someone who's been doing this for a while and like gets bored by things when they feel very stagnant.
Yeah.
It's been nice to have someone to come in to just like get me to remind me of my past and where I came from and like really loving and enjoying what I'm doing. And it looks different, like to your point. It's like, I'm not going to have the energy that you have. I'm not going to bring what you bring.
There's no like manual to it.
Not yet. I create one. Dude, we got lots of ideas, bro. Lots of ideas. Speaking of ideas, on your phone, it says Frenzy. Do you want to talk about that?
Frenzy is an app. It's the name of an app that I have had the idea.
Today's podcast is brought to you by Frenzy.
Yes. And Frenzy is an idea that I've had for an app for a while now, probably like over 3 years. The basic concept is to make it easier, more efficient, and just overall better experience to like hang out with your friends and to create those opportunities to hang out with friends. So on the app, you'll be able to like create, I don't like using the term event, but basically you'll be able to create like a hangout, and you type in the title, like what it is, a description to it, and then like the time, location, and like some other things that you would fill in for kind of like a calendar event. From there, you'll be able to share it to like a individual, kind of like think Snapchat of just like send it to this person, this person, this person, this person, or you'll be able to send it to an existing group or a new group. Like if you're looking for more friends, people to hang out with, it's solely for your friends and friends that you already have, not necessarily to make new friends, not like Tinder, not like Instagram, friends that you already have added by phone number or like QR code or username, and you have them on the app. Basically, the invite comes in on the receiving end, and this is where it's just like clear cut, no communication really, no chat. It's just like, I'm in or I'm out. So like, no excuse. I don't need to hear that like your dog ate your homework or whatever.
Dude, just can like, I be honest?
Tell me you're in or you're out.
It's not, you haven't, are you, how do you feel about the name?
Why?
Because now I kind of think I'm in is pretty sick.
Ooh. You know, I'm always open. I'm always open to things. And I don't know if we should say it here, but someone else came up with the name technically.
Really?
Yeah. Not someone else. Someone that used to be in my life.
And so where are you at in the like development of this app?
I haven't trademarked it yet. So, but I mean, we have all the logo and everything, but like you can always change that sort of thing. But I'm in. Could be really good.
And where did you get the idea for this?
Okay. So yeah. That's what I needed to tell, but I couldn't tell that without you.
Yeah. So, and I got to be honest. I like, you've told me what it is and I don't fully remember and I couldn't fully hear everything.
So, and there's like different features to it and you kind of have to explain all of them to make it like.
All I know is I'm in.
Look, that's the logo. It's a high five.
Pretty good.
So I like that. We'll talk later about that. Anyways, so the idea came from actually, I'm pretty sure it was my first time like coming home after going to college. I think it was like winter break or something like that. And I was with my friend, best friend, Ben Cash, shout out. And we were hanging out back home. You know that feeling of like, oh, who's around? Like, who do we hang out with? We want to just go play spike ball or whatever the game may be. We want to just go to the pool, but we want friends to come. And so like the first thought was when we wanted to go play spike ball and we were like, who do we invite? Like, who do we ask? Do we ask this person? Do we like text them? Are we still friends with them? Like, are they even around? And it just gave me the idea of just like, there's kind of like a screw it aspect to it too. Like, I feel like when you're texting someone, it's like they have to respond to you. There's like a stigma to it where, oh, what if they don't reply? What if they don't want to? Like, you don't want to hear their BS excuse. This is kind of just like throwing it out there. Like, do you want to just come play spike ball or what?
And anyone can respond or just people in your group?
So you create like the plan and you send it out to who you want to. But there will also be another feature where you can send it out to like basically a live dashboard. I like that position. Didn't mean it like that. You'll send it out
to. We know how you meant it, but.
You send it out to like a live dashboard. So I'll stay on like the spike ball example. It's you and I, we're going to play spike ball. Obviously you need four people. So it's like perfect for things like that as well. Like we're going bowling, but we want other people to come. We're going to the pool, but we want other people to come.
And so tell me, I remember asking you this question before. Why wouldn't I just do that in a group chat?
A couple reasons, like people don't always respond in group chats. We all have that one friend that like doesn't respond at all. People are hesitant. Like I've done not like a
wait. I'm that friend. I'm the friend who gets put in group chats. Yeah, and if I like,
no,
if
you're
I don't,
great. You make my app. You're great.
No. Or maybe yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. What I'm trying to say is I'm the guy in group chats that if someone starts a group chat and they start talking about something, I'm like, maybe I find some little funny thing and I say it, but I'm not the guy.
You send a GIF, don't you? That's it.
No. Words. I use my words.
Okay.
Yeah, but I get overwhelmed by the energy of
the group chat. And you don't, there's just a different vibe. And like, I tell people that all the time I'll come back to like that question directly, but like, why Snapchat? Why Instagram? Why this app? Instagram has all the features, not all the features, but like the main features that Snapchat has, but most people don't go on Instagram and Snapchat each other.
No, because Snapchat's for naked pictures.
Okay. Anyways, what was your direct question? Oh, why can't you just go to a group chat? For people like you, there's a little more of like a commitment aspect. There's supposed to be, and we'll like figure all this out of like how it'll be exactly so that there is isn't and doesn't have to be a lot of communication. We're working with like toggle on and off things, like checklists and polls and stuff like that, so that it's one, all in the app, all right there, and more of like a committed plan type thing, even if it's like the simplest thing, like going to lunch. And then again, in group chats, like things get lost, you know, you send the idea or what you want to do, and then there's a bunch of conversation and no one actually gets to it. So it's like, here it is, all on the app. Comes in, you just, I'm in or I'm out, and then it organizes it all right there for you. And then you have like an accountability aspect to it. And then it can go into the calendar aspect or the calendar feature on the app too.
Okay. Wait a second.
That whole thing.
Snapchat is for naked pictures.
Okay.
Change my mind.
I love change my mind.
Bro, who the,
I can't change your
mind. No, listen. Who the fuck? Because I remember when Snapchat came out and it was like, I don't remember if Instagram, I think it was.
Okay, it started as that. Had to be.
Well, no, listen. So I'm pretty sure it went Snapchat and then Instagram, and then Instagram came out with the feature that you can send like video or you can send a photo to friends like that. And then it was like, who the fuck is still using Snapchat? And now it's been so much time where I'm like, who the fuck is using Snapchat? I don't understand. Like, dude, you have TikTok if you want to just blow up your mind with information. Instagram, it's like Instagram has every feature that all those other things have. And I don't understand why you would still use Snapchat.
So you're saying, why would people use Snapchat when they have those features on Instagram?
All I'm saying is...
Is that kind of what you're saying? Because I
don't understand why have so many different apps when there's one that does basically all those things. Now, TikTok, I kind of understand. I'm starting to understand more. And Instagram, it's like just, it seems to just be the mecca. Like, who the fuck is using Facebook? Our parents, you know? Who still uses that?
Dude, and that's the world. That's like, why do you drink Pepsi instead of Coke?
100%. So that's why I'm here to get to the bottom of it.
Okay.
Why do people still use Snapchat?
I think the functionality aspect of it and the... So like you go to Snapchat and the main thing right there is like all your friends and the people you're talking to. You go on Instagram, there's everyone and what they're posting, not necessarily what Snapchat provides right there of like the main functionality of it.
Right. Because when you open up Snapchat, it basically takes you straight to like if you were on stories on Instagram, right?
No, if you were on like your DMs.
Right. But I mean like that feature of you can take a photo or video right away. It's the first thing you can do.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Gotcha. You know? Yes.
I guess. Yeah. I don't know. I'm just curious because I also have, there's some younger guys I know that use it a lot and you use it like pretty... Not for Nikki Nibbins, but you do a little bit.
I use it now that I'm overseas because I can't text. So that's one of the ways I can text people. Because
rather than iMessage or whatever?
I can't right now. Like I took out my SIM.
Okay, got it.
So I'm on like foreign SIM. But when I'm back home, like there's been times, do you even know what like the best friends list is?
Dude, I'm not like ancient, bro.
Oh, you're really against Snapchat. I don't know.
No, dude. Don't get me. Don't get it twisted. I'm not against Snapchat. I don't give a fucking shit what anyone does. All I'm saying is like I just don't understand. The only thing that makes sense to me is we're sending naked photos. That's the only thing where it's like, okay, you want like your little secret app for it and you're friends with like some chick who put her Snap thing on under her Instagram profile. Like
that is ridiculous.
You know, that kind of stuff. And so, but I'm like, what I find so interesting is like use it to like, what up, dude?
Yeah.
Whereas like I would just text a friend and if I was doing something or like if I saw an image that represented like a friend of mine and I needed to send it to him, I would just text it to him.
Interesting.
So I'm assuming you use Snapchat. Okay. Maybe you're using it for a specific reason right now.
But
I'm assuming you use Snapchat the same way you do back home as you do out here.
No, not the same way for sure. I definitely Snapchat like less people because I feel like when you're gone too, it's like a way to keep in touch that's not just like on text as well. You know, like you can Snapchat them, see your face. I just had my parents add me on Snapchat so that I can send like, so you're saying like send a picture, send video. And this is actually, oh, this is so cool. This is one of the reasons you need Frenzy as well because you can take the event and send it to multiple people. On Snapchat, you can take that video, take that picture and send it to multiple people like right away without it being a group chat, going through and selecting people. Does that make sense?
Say it again.
So I can go, if I go to the center down here and it's like beautiful, it's like, oh my gosh, I can take that video. I press next and then I can select who I want to send it to. I can send it to a group chat. I can send it to my
mom and dad. Why wouldn't you just post it on your story though for everyone to see?
I do that sometimes, but like that's different than sending it to someone.
In some way, do you feel it's more personable?
Yeah, 100%.
That's like, do you think people receive it that way? Like, for example, if I put it on my story, it's just for everyone to see. You're saying that there's something extra. Yeah, I don't really
use, other than like now, I don't really go on Snapchat for like stories that much.
Yeah, but you're in a college environment right now, right? And I could have told you what I thought of Snapchat when I was in college. And that's what I'm saying. I'm trying to connect a little bit of space that's happened, you know?
No, there's time definitely, like, I guess I'm not the guy to talk to about Snapchat because there's definitely people that use it a lot. And like, what I don't get is where people are literally just like Snapchat back and forth.
Well, I'll tell you one right now. His name's Tijon Mustard DeFalco, dude. And he's like in between our generation, but in between us, you know? Yeah. And so that's why I was like, dude, that guy used Snapchat exactly how you describe it, in the sense of like, what up? Like talking to his sister and his family, and like that's how he did it. And I in my head, I'm just like, why wouldn't you just text them? And if you're gonna send them a photo, sick. And there was something, I remember him describing it in some way, like just sending a photo and having some text is like, it hits harder than if I just say like, what up, Mason?
I think there's the efficiency aspect as well. You can just like take the photo, type right there and send it. And it like sends right away too. There's like messages. It takes longer. It takes more storage. I don't know if we really want to get into it. I think it's just like the functionality aspect to it, and like why the app is what it is, and that's what I hope Frenzy can be.
Boom. That's pretty sick, dude. I didn't really want to write questions down for this because we're just fucking hanging out. But I was thinking about this the other day. I was like, do you shower with the team?
I did once when I used your towel.
Okay. Because I've noticed, like, and this is the same when I've played overseas pro, it's like the younger Americans. Guys don't, maybe not, but like sometimes the younger guys don't feel comfortable showering with everyone.
I don't really care. I'm not the guy, there's like guys, and I've learned like mostly foreign guys, I think it's American culture, that like don't care. They like drop their pants right there. They go and like shower, they'll walk back naked, like whatever, which is like fine to me. I don't care. That's just like not my style. I like have my towel around me. Not that I like am a freak about it.
No, baby, but
I'll go, like I'll shower, like it's cool, but like I don't need to be standing there waiting naked. Like I'll go and shower when it's my time to shower, and then I'll like walk back.
I mean,
but
it is such, I
forgot a towel every time we had showered, so
yeah
and I didn't play one of the times, so
shower
when I get back.
It's all good, and I don't care either way. I could not agree more with you, where most of my experience has been with foreign guys, like no one gives a shit. And I'm sure it's a, like, this is not new news to anyone. I'm sure it's a cultural thing.
100%. At Long Beach, I shower after every practice, like locker room, like I guess that's like part of the routine too. It's just like, boom, practice, shower, get to change, and then I go home and do whatever I want clean. But yeah, I don't have a problem with it. How about you?
Yeah. No, but I did. I think I was insecure for a long time.
When you were younger?
Yeah.
Like when you were younger?
Yeah, yeah, for sure. I definitely was. And which is for me, like very strange because I'm a pretty open guy, you know? But I think...
there's definitely like some...
I honestly think it was being raised in like a Christian home.
Oh, really?
Yeah, where like my dad didn't like walk around naked in front of us, or like, you know, like I didn't mean
well,
us.
Yeah,
me
neither.
I mean me and my brother. I just mean like if I had kids, like I think if I had kids now, it's like it's your naked body. Like who cares?
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So you're like, I don't see that.
I don't see the deal in it.
Like I don't have that.
Yeah.
Thought or that perspective.
Well, hopefully you're not thinking about having kids at 21. I don't know if you are. Are you?
Well, not right now. That'd be a little awkward.
Like, I heard you say no cap one time.
Oof, that's a joke.
Yeah, no. There's no hate, baby. I'm just saying, I heard you say no cap one time, and I'm thinking right now, is there a cap for having kids? Like, is it something that...
Do I want to have kids?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, one day.
Yeah.
Because I guess I ask you that because, dude, I'll be completely honest. Like, in my life, I never... like really thought about having a family one day.
Interesting. No, I've thought about it for
like
a
when
while.
You hear, and this is, let's speak stereotypically here because that's the best way to speak publicly. Like most women plan for their future a little more than most men, right? I think so. And
in some aspects, yeah.
Sure. And I think when I think about like having kids or having a family, at least for me, it's only as of my recent years, as I've gotten older, that I'm starting to feel and see, oh, this would be really cool. Like to find a partner and like have some kids or just like start a family in some way, I think is a really cool concept and cool idea. But I was not that way as a kid. And then I've had some friends that since they were, you know, in high school or in college were like, oh, having a family is a priority for me. Yeah. I want that one day.
I'd say that's more me.
Yeah.
Or like I've just always thought about it. And it probably comes from like being raised in a family that's like pretty close and like family's important. Yeah, I've always wanted, and I've always been in relationships too. And I've always kind of like thought about it that way. I'm like dating this person for the future, technically. Not saying that like 100% it will work out. I've kind of like had that mindset and I'm pretty like, I can never like find the right word, like strict on that of just like,
yeah,
that's my way of going into it. I'm never just like messing around or like whatever. And both of my relationships have been very long.
Cause my boy's committed. We went over that in the beginning.
Yeah, exactly. So like, it's definitely something I think about. Like I have written down like baby names that I think would be cool and like stuff like that.
Dude, yeah. You got any off the top of your head?
Shaw for a guy. So my middle name is Shaw, Mason Shaw. And I think that would be sick. For
James sons. Shaw would be stoked.
I know. He stole my number too.
Wow.
Girl name.
That's all right, by the way. I'm number 19. Who the fuck cares about number 19, bro? I'm also pissed. Ben or Patrick Gassman stole my number 13. I didn't even think about it when Ben left.
No
grab
way.
Grab that number. I know. I'm so sad. I'm like, number 19.
He doesn't
so
even
boring.
Care about it. You should
I'm
ask.
Sure he doesn't care. I probably could.
Okay.
I've kind of just accepted it at this point. Like, I don't really care about numbers. I don't really care, but I will say I have the number that absolutely suits me right now if you don't care, and it's number 19, because who the fuck is number 19? Name me that's one.
It's just like the I don't care number.
I mean, just name me one player you've ever known who wears number 19.
Taylor Averill, that's it.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
There's no one out there, so it's...
Do you have a baby name?
Sometimes it gets me down, you know?
Gets you down.
Nah.
Do you have a baby name?
Yeah, I think I had a couple. Should I read some? I think I've written some down. As I've gotten older, you know, I think about it a little bit.
While you're looking, I'll tell you. So my mom, if any of us were, because there's three boys, if she had a girl, the name was going to be Colette.
For you?
Colette Noel. Like,
dude,
if she had a girl.
I was going to be Nicole.
No way. So I think Colette, I really like that name. And I think it's like pretty, it's not popular. And just like has a nice sound to it. So I think that'd be a cool girl name. I have a couple more, but.
All right. I want to start off by saying I'm not married to any of these. These were written.
Disclaimer.
These were written February 25th of 2022. A lot of time has passed. You know what I mean? A lot of time.
Okay. Yeah. You think on them. Yeah. Sometimes I'll do the same thing and then I delete one right away. I'm like, no way.
And some of these are mildly influenced. Like they weren't all, they
on
weren't like
the
me really thinking about, they were just, I was just like, oh, that name.
Okay, got it.
You're going to love the first one. You ready? Arson.
That's crazy.
You love that because your dad's an arsonist. That's why.
He's an arsonist.
An arsonist or an arson detector.
Or he worked in the arson investigation department.
Arson investigation department. Yeah. All right, that's the first one. The second one is Papillon.
Dude, I should have known. You're going to have some...
Also, if you guys got any good baby names, please send them my way.
And my way.
And yeah.
But mine are probably a little bit different than yours.
If you want to be more personal, just send us the specific names you think would fit for our children.
Yeah.
You know, you're more Italian, so I'm thinking Marco, probably.
No.
Giuseppe.
My grandpa's Italian.
You know?
There's no Marco.
All right, we'll keep going. Szechuan.
You're kidding.
Ragnar. I mean, come on. You kidding me? A little Viking boy? I have in here first name Christian, second name or middle name Born Again. I don't know why that's in my kids' names. And then Mordecai. Honestly, other than Szechuan, which sounds you like that one. I knew you'd like that one. I can't even believe it's in this list, dude. Honestly, I don't like any of like now when I read these, I don't like
Szechuan?
Any of them.
Szechuan?
I don't know if it's because I'm really insecure in this moment right now about kids' names.
Sorry, I'm not meaning to laugh at you.
No, I mean, Christian Born Again, bro. If I name my kid Christian Born Again, it's over for me, dude.
I have Sander, I think would be a cool guy name.
Wow, so far, Mason's two names are
I know,
James Shaw and Taylor Sander, dude.
They were written down before I even knew them.
All right, that's fair.
What else do I have? My dad's name is Steven. I don't know if Steve's I could do class. That.
Can I make a suggestion for you?
I think that'd be really cool.
I think Gary. I brought this up the other day. I was like, I think Gary is one of the few names that has died. Like Gary's died. Yeah. All the Garys are dead.
I think.
Or they're close to death.
Can we go this way? Is this allowed?
Yeah. Here, wait. Scoot a little bit over there. We'll scoot on the right side so we're not too close to each other. I think we can both go this. This is.
Is it still filming? This is adorable. This is nice. Yeah, this little is change really of nice. Scene. Am I close enough? Can it see me?
Wait, just yeah. to confirm that theory. Do you know anyone named Gary?
Yeah.
Under the age of 30?
Yes.
Who?
Gary. I know two. They were on my Long Beach volleyball team. Two at the same time. What? I don't think I'm in the frame, but that's okay.
No, you are.
No, there's no way. You scoot that way. The camera's over there.
Bro, it's not about camera time. God, Mason. You know what, dude? I knew getting on the mic with a content TikTok star.
Dude, I could be over here.
Hey, can we be honest for a second? Bro, Mason looks like a guy who should be in a TikTok house making content for a living. You are a beautiful man, dude. A beautiful man boy.
Thanks, bro.
I mean, it's true, dude. You got the hair for it. I've seen the videos of like guys who go into like TikTok houses and make like, they're just there to make content.
Yeah, I don't know if this is a compliment, but thanks.
I mean, you're a beautiful man. What I'm saying is sky's the limit, you know?
Sky is the limit. Yeah, if I didn't do volleyball, I'd probably do a little bit more on...
Yeah, what would you do if you didn't do volleyball? And let's just say Frenzy wasn't a potential thing yet. Like, what else would you like to do?
That would be like the one thing, like some entrepreneurship type of thing. But at this point, probably like modeling. Actually, I would never usually say that, but...
Do you do do you do any sort of modeling stuff right now?
A little bit. Yeah, like technically I have an agency, but I haven't done much just because like I'm playing volleyball like every day of the year. While we were in Brazil, I got like a casting opportunity for a Nike shoot, but I couldn't do it.
For what? What exactly?
It was like a Nike running thing or something like that.
Have you done any like campaigns or anything?
Not for a company, like paid, but I've done like test shoots and shoots for like agency and just like my own stuff.
No paid gigs yet? Dude, also how sick is it now?
Maybe
that,
one.
And I'm sure this conversation has already been had, so we don't need to blow it up by any means, but like how sick is it that you can finally get paid and work other jobs and like do other things to make money?
Like the NIL stuff?
Yes, I was gonna. Yes.
So actually, this is good for the podcast because I was kind of like not against it at first, but just like not really for it. I think it was like a slippery slope. Like
for individualism, you mean like not promoting?
That too, but like just the NCAA as a whole. And like I was never set on like any idea of it. Just like knew that it could kind of make things tricky, and now you have like quarterbacks making $8 million. So it's like, I don't know, I just feel like that's sketchy. And then you have like, once it'll happen eventually, like creep into like smaller sports and there'll be some interesting things. But anyways, now I love it.
How are you taking advantage of it? Or other players? Like, do you see people or kids that are on different teams that are now like seeking certain things out?
Yeah, so like a lot of what I've seen, at least in our sports, I guess like men's and women's side, maybe women's a little bit less. I mean, I'll get there. So like, I think a lot of people are kind of like into the ambassadorship, like type of thing. You know, you have like an affiliate code, they give you free product, they give you this, they give you that. Like, that's cool. I like did maybe one or two of those things, but I was like kind of reluctant to post about it if I had to, just cause like, I don't like flooding my feed with things, especially if it's not something that I like genuinely support. So I think you'll see a lot of that, at least for a while. Then there's like a few people that can like actually get some really cool deals, maybe like long-term partnerships or like paid gigs, whether that's like a one-off thing or like a long-term thing. And I'd say like that's kind of where I'm at now. Like I wouldn't do something for free unless it was like really, really, really genuine and like maybe one of my homies or something.
Let me ask you too. Sorry to interrupt you, but you've like as of the last what year, have you like blown up on Instagram more?
Yeah.
What's up with that?
Reels.
Reels is the way to just blast.
Yeah, we were lucky enough.
Daddy's on the reel train, dude. I feel
you. I know. Yeah. We were lucky enough to have people at Long Beach that videoed for us. Shout out Olivia and Holly and a couple others. We had a bunch of content. It was like cool volleyball videos, even if
good.
It was like,
dude, those, that quality like content was good.
That's why, like, that's why I started posting. I'm like, this is like a freaking movie. Like, whether it's just a regular pass or not, like, this is sick. And then I just started posting. Like, I posted a couple times. It was actually, I've given like credit to, I guess, my ex-girlfriend now at this point, a couple times of like, I was never really into like the Instagram thing. I knew I should, and like, it would help and like that sort of thing. And there were like benefits to it, but I wasn't like super, super into it. And I knew it like maybe would come again, like, you know, you should be in a TikTok house or something like that.
Baby, first of all, you say like, that's so sad. Why are you saying that so sadly?
I don't know. Anyways, then I started like posting.
Wait. Also, I didn't say you should be in there.
Could be.
I'm saying you look like you could be.
Thanks, bro.
And Sync, Backstreet Boys, like, you're just a beautiful Italian man.
I love that's all you I was keep trying to referring say. To the Italian.
Well, like, yeah, I think your hair like, needs an explanation. Is God, it, yeah, is it's really fucking curly gorgeous.
I don't know. It just happened after the shower. Anyways, where are we at? Then I started posting a lot of reels, and it was going well for me. And then I was able to earn off of the reels. And then I was like, okay, like, they want me to post more, basically. That's what they're saying. And then I was like, yeah, it's like cool. I can keep doing this while earning off of it. And then, well, actually, how it really started in my Instagram in general, before I even had a lot of followers, I think I've told this story like a couple times, is when I did these like USA things. I never really had someone when I was younger to like not look up to, but just to like see what was going on, see like how it went, get insight like this. And obviously now it's grown even more just because technology has grown. But I kind of wanted to be that for some people, that slash, like, we had this conversation earlier. That's funny. I would just post to my stories and post like on my feed and stuff when I did these types of trips for like the youth age group and all that, so that my family would know like what was going on. And so they knew like, oh, you did this, you did that. Cause you can't talk to them all the time or throughout the day or send them every single picture. So it's just like, oh, put it on Instagram. They'll be able to see it. Especially like my extended family, where it's like, I'm not going to text them every day.
I mean, that's, to me, the best part about social media in general is like, there's so, especially like playing overseas for so long, there's guys that like, they were in my world every day and then I just don't see them. And if it weren't for social media, I would like not know what they were up to, or like, you know, you see someone randomly and then I'm like, oh yeah, I haven't fucking talked to that guy in so long. Like, let me hit him up, you know, like, I think it's such a beautiful thing. And quite honestly, I feel like it's starting to catch on more. And I know that because I see more parents trying to use it now too, which is awesome. I just think there's like still so many great things to share. And there's so many people. That's why I started this podcast. It's like, I love having these conversations, you know, like they're fucking awesome. And I like want to create a space to just like authentically express myself and like hopefully pull that out of the person I'm speaking with. And I think it's so good for people to listen to, because I think a lot of people have questions that they're too afraid to ask.
Yeah, you know, they think
like
that they
if
can't.
I can inadvertently answer a bunch of questions or make people feel like, oh, I also deal with like addiction stuff, or like, oh, I'm also a sober athlete. Like, I think it's fucking sick.
Yeah,
you know?
Like, people would never know. That's one of the things you would never know about me unless if you knew.
And
like, because I don't post about that. Hey, I'm a sober athlete. You
why
know?
Not?
I've actually
just kidding. Who fucking cares?
No, I've thought about like a blog, like eventually like a blog type thing, or like a way, like a space, because like Instagram, I'm not gonna like post that again. Like, certain apps have certain vibes to me. But I've thought of like a blog, and I guess that kind of continues to answer the original question of just like, now it's just been cool to be able to like connect with people and like be of service to them, or ask, they can ask questions or just talk to. Like, that's why I'll go live sometimes too, is just like connect with people, and that's what I'm all about. And like, that's why I'm.
What do you do in your lives? I honestly don't do enough lives.
So usually I started going on recently because my friends would go on and then I would join their lives, and then we would like be on live together. And then I was like, oh geez, there's a lot of people on here. So then I just go live like sometimes if I'm in like either while I was driving and like bored, or like while my brother was driving.
Okay. Here's like a classic older generation speaking to the younger generation. I'm like, oh, all these kids are on their phones too much and they're on TikTok and Instagram. Do you think some of that's true, or do you think it's
100%.
Like, yeah. You think it's like becoming a problem?
Yeah. I always like,
because dude,
people probably assume that I'm like on Instagram a lot or like on TikTok. I don't go on TikTok really at all, but like, I would say I'm on like the user, or not the user end. I'm on like the one providing content end of it. So it's a little bit different for me, and I try and like stay, like keep it that way for the most part, but I'm not like a scroller, and there's like people, and they're like fine talking about it, or like they know, it's like they'll scroll on TikTok for like 3 hours. I don't know. Like my brother goes on TikTok, but a lot of it's like informational, and like his feed has now become like informational in a way. Whereas like you could go on YouTube and watch a video for an hour of like learning or whatever. And I think that's like, it could be similar. It all depends like what you use it for.
It's so hard because like, even for myself, I've luckily gotten so much better, but it's so, dude, especially, and I keep saying when you're overseas, because it's just so different when you're all alone. Like when you're back home or you're in college, like there's so much to distract you. Like there's so much going on. When you're just straight up alone overseas and your training's over and you have 3 or 4 hours until you got to go to bed, it's like, dude, I'll catch myself all the time being like, oh, I'm going to post something. And I like do the work, I post the thing, and then I'm like scrolling for a second just to like see what's up. And then you just get lost. It's just so, and this is like fucking everyone's talking about it, you know? But I guess I was curious from you, because I could see how addicting it would be, especially as someone who's like, that's the thing is, I think there's a lot of Instagrammers that are just like on the consumer end of it, which is a part of the reason why I finally was like, I gotta start doing some shit. Like I was seeing people, let's call it in quotes, like succeeding in my world doing like social media stuff. And I'm like, that guy's dull as fuck. Like, what? Like, he's not relatable to me at all. And he's saying all this like really cringy quotes and just like doing that kind of thing. And I'm like, I don't relate to that at all. Yeah. I got to create a space now and share my story a little bit.
And just make it yours.
And that's what's been so sick. Like when I first started posting stuff like 2 years ago, and then slowly getting feedback, showing people like what I'm into and like a bit more of my personality.
Yeah.
And like figuring out like, oh, I think I have this ability to connect with like a different group in the volleyball world and maybe just in the life in general as like an athlete. And I think that's why like now I've like push everyone to hop on and share shit, you know?
Me too. Because that's literally my number one piece of advice. If you have 3,000 followers or if you have 200,000 followers, whatever. It's like, whatever the number is, they're following you, you know? Like they, to some extent, should care what's going on. Or like, I even think about it back to my parents. It's like, at least my parents are on there and they care or they want to see what's up. I always say is like, someone out there cares or eventually will care. And you think about even like famous people or like these TikTok stars now, it's like people are watching them, looking at them for a reason or whatever it may be, or whatever the little niche is. It's like, just be you and post what's going on. And like, it doesn't mean you have to like become famous or that you are going to become famous, but you're just being yourself. And that's where you have to start, is you can't be in it for the opposite reason of just like, oh, there's this opportunity, I have to. But more so to me of like, why not?
Or just like,
like a you won't. Like it's more of like a you won't.
You do that for me?
Yeah.
That was really sweet.
Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I mean, totally. It totally does. And I, here's what I think about too, is like, I think as an athlete, especially as a pro volleyball player, most American players who want to play professionally aren't going to make a ton of money, most of them.
Mm-hmm.
And so you got to find other sources of 100%. Revenue, of income. And maybe you're into like stocks, you know, just having a conversation with Jungle Cat about stocks, you know, and investing and that kind of thing. And who knows what, maybe he wants to get into that when he's done. Like, that's awesome.
Yeah.
But I think there's this like short window to really maximize your time as an athlete. And I think doing things on social media with intention, like with purpose, not just like doing them to do them. I think that's, if that's where you need to start, great. But eventually figuring out what your voice is, who you're speaking to, and understanding the value that you're providing people. And that was my thing. That's where I got lost in the beginning, where I'd poke out. I was super into the fitness side of things because it changed my life and changed my career.
Yeah.
And so that's what I started sharing. And I knew I had learned some very unorthodox methods and knew some interesting people. And started posting stuff. And I had so many times where, my feet are really cold. My toes get really cold. Thanks, baby. And I have so many times where I would post something being like, what the fuck am I doing? I'm just like posting a video of me at the beach working out with like my shirt off and like like, what is this really doing? But then I started getting messages from random kids exactly. all over the world being like, yo, this is sick. Do you have any advice with this? And I was like, I'm going to dedicate. Now it's hard to respond to everyone or yeah. like they get lost sometimes. So I'm sorry.
The way they need to come in, sorry to cut you off, but like Instagram needs to help with that whole thing. Like I get people, oh, you don't follow me back. Or it's like, oh, you never saw my message. But like, I literally never saw it.
Yeah.
So like
maybe, but are you, that's an interesting, like a filtration process would be really interesting.
They have updated it recently, but it's still like tough. And then there's like
primary in general.
Yeah, but I don't get it. And there's like hidden messages. And then there's like some messages I'll go on the like requests where they come in on like requests and then they're not there.
Well, so this is like,
they're like not organized correctly.
For sure. And I think like you bring up such a great point because I got to the point where I was like, all right, I'm going to take time out of my day and I'm going to respond to everyone who sends me a message. And then people were like, oh, he'll just answer any question. Then I get tons of questions. And then to be honest, then I get just tons of like really not well thought out questions. Yeah. Like how do I jump higher? Or just like send me these long messages about like something very specific to them. And then they ask me like a broad question.
Yeah.
And at first it's like, yeah, I want to jump higher. I want to hit harder. I'm going to hopefully share unintentionally resources to improve those things, but there's such a bigger message there. All that to say, that's when I took it upon myself to be like, I got to create resources not to have to answer everyone's individual question, which is why I'm building and just about to launch like my Middle Blocker Academy, which is why I started working with kids one-on-one doing the mentorship stuff. Like that stuff is so fulfilling. It's so rewarding. And it just helps because the reality is like, you can't get to everyone and that you have a great, like you have a pretty big following and you're young for such a young kid, like that will continue to grow. Yep. And the reality is like, you can't be as much as someone like you maybe wants to respond to everyone. Yeah, and sometimes you just don't have the time. And quite frankly, you don't want to spend 2 or 3 hours of your time on social media, just responding
to people.
In general.
It's time. I mean, we're talking about business. Kind of, right?
What do they say in business? Time is money, baby. Time is money.
Exactly. So I like how you said it. It's like you've created other opportunities or other ways that people can do it. And same thing with me and my one-on-one mentorships that I'm doing it. Like I even remind them, I'm like, I'm here for you. Like this is your time. Like you're putting in the effort, time, and money to be here and to meet with me. And you're one of a few, you know, or more than a few. And that means something to me as well. And so even if you want to talk about, I don't know, your dog that died, or if you want to ask me a question about recruiting, like this is for you, this is your time. Yeah, we'll talk about volleyball, obviously, and we'll go through all of that. But I can't meet with everyone. I can't talk with everyone. You're paying the price too, and you deserve that. So that's kind of what I'm playing around with. Instagram just came out with like a new feature, I guess, of like subscribers. So people can subscribe to my page. And
do you have to have a certain amount of followers to have that feature? How does that work?
I don't know. It's same. So like you can earn off your reels now, right? Or no?
I've been getting those messages to earn off my reels for so long. I don't really know how it works. Like,
it's so funny.
Well, you know what? We'll talk about, we can talk about this another time.
Okay. Yeah. But anyways, like, I don't know. My understanding of all of it is like they're all in like a beta phase technically. So they're just like pushing it to like different influencers or different people with like different numbers of followings as well. Anyways, I got the subscriber thing and I'm kind of like playing around with that, seeing what I want to like make of it or seeing like what type of people I like have on. I think I have like 10 now, which is like pretty cool. And it's just like people that want to pay that price to like, right now I'm just like pushing like some extra content or like more inside things of like, maybe I don't want everyone to see this, or at least, I guess it kind of goes back. It's kind of cool. It goes back to the original conversation is like, these people are paying to subscribe to me. I know they care. I know they want to see what's going on. So I'll send this to them, or like I'll put it on my subscriber story. Interesting thought.
What do you think you're going to send? Like,
pictures, not send.
Pictures
like
your feet?
No. Someone asked me, what is this? Will you be posting like extra pictures in that way or something like that?
Instagram's trying to capitalize on OnlyFans, dude. They're trying to beat them. I'm telling you, Instagram is like, they took a little from Snapchat. They took a little from Facebook. They took a little bit. They're taking from TikTok.
I know. I like
that's
that
my point. I was like, let's just keep it all in one place,
exactly.
Baby.
That's
why
I never did, or like I haven't yet. I haven't done like the Patreon thing. I haven't done whatever other options. I haven't even looked into it. It's just like, it's too much like to juggle that in so many different places. But if I can just be on Instagram and they say, hey, subscribers. It's a new feature that's offered. Like, sure. And then next thing you know, I have like 10 subscribers. If we can get that to 100, then, you know, there's some real money coming in.
Yeah.
So I think that's something that I need to like work on and actually structure and plan is like, hey, if you want to be a subscriber, I'll offer this, or I will be posting this many more times, or stuff like that. And I'll post like some inside stuff, like I said, or maybe, I don't know an exact example.
What's going on Mason's insides?
Yeah, like I...
Emotionally? Oh, I yeah. Like, you could do... Take a little baby drone down there.
Yeah.
Like magic school
bus. I had a dream about a drone. I just realized that.
Really?
Yeah.
What was it?
The new... Wait, was it a dream? Yeah, it was a dream. Oh my gosh, that's amazing. The new... There's a new drone. It's out. It shoots vertical.
I mean, so you like, and I...
The camera flips.
That's sick.
Yeah.
You and I talked about this like a couple nights ago because I've been popping. Every time I travel, I pop melatonin. I just need I need to guarantee that sleep for myself. And I've been having wild dreams. I told you the one I had the other day where it was like there was this kid and he had these like big like garden clippers and he was trying to fucking stab me with them. And like my family and like the people I loved were like in this house and I was just... It was like, I could easily be like, yeah, what are you, like, grabbing by his head? You know what? I kept pushing him away, like, dude, what are you doing? And he's like trying to fucking cut me with these garden
How
clippers.
How old was he? Like eight?
Eight or nine. Yeah. Like, who knows, you know? And I just remember being like, do I have to, like, what do I do? Like, he just wouldn't stop, you know? Like, he just
Do I have to kill this kid right
That's
now?
What I was thinking about. And it's funny because I, like, luckily woke up after and, like, I laid in bed for, like, 10 minutes. Like, do I have what it takes to... kill a child
saying that?
If they're trying to kill my family? Like, dude, that's tough.
That's a tough question. We'll let you guys answer that.
Yeah. If anyone has any advice, dude, I'm really having a hard time handling.
I don't know if I can be your therapist on that one.
No, I'd be, to be quite honest with you, everyone's their own best therapist sometimes, you know, and this is really going to be one I'll have to sit down and work out, and I will. All right. This was great, dude. We've crushed. We've been like almost probably 2 hours. This has been great.
For real?
Yeah. We've been doing this for a while.
Love that.
We got Mexico tonight, 5:30. Normally this is nap time for daddy. You know, daddy takes a little nap time, but this has been great. I'm happy I didn't nap. I'm happy we stayed up. You've now given me energy, which is what you do, dude. And I will say you've been quite a delight as a surprise. As a roommate, you can handle, you can kind of handle it all, you know, you can authentically be yourself. And that's really all I care about in a friendship. And quite honestly, as a roommate, so I feel pretty honored to be with such young blood, you know, giving me that energy.
Yeah, that's what we do.
Hell yeah. All right.
Appreciate it.
I also, just as a last thing, want to give you an opportunity. I mean, I'm sure, first of all, I don't even remember if I introduced you or not, but introduce or de-introduce.
De-introduce
yourself. Where can people find you and get involved?
That's a good call. Well, my name is Mason Briggs. I'm from Valencia, California. And
you said Santa Clarita, didn't you?
Same thing. Santa Clarita is like the, I guess like.
All right. Where can people follow about what you're going on? What you got going
on? I'm on Instagram. That's like my main thing. Not Snapchat. Instagram and TikTok, but mainly Instagram.
Snapchat will be in the link. Every now and link then. Description below.
No. I don't like that. Frenzy. You can find me on Frenzy. Instagram, Mason S. Briggs. S is my initial for my middle name.
Which is what?
Shaw. Which is Shaw. Yeah, we went over that earlier. So, yeah, follow me. Message me.
Good times, baby.
Comment and subscribe.
And you know what? We might even do more of these. I wanted to do a bedtime series with you, like a bedtime story series.
Oh, I mean, our bedtime talks are good.
We have really good bedtime talks. And I think that would be really fun to do. So, we'll think about it. I mean, hopefully this works. We can upload it and everything goes smooth. And if this process goes smooth, we'll just start pumping them out. Yeah. We can do a lot of fun little things.
That'd be cool.
Sick.
We'll do like little roommate series. It's fun. It's been real.